Thursday night, 2021. Invite somebody to share this live stream with you. I've been replaying some of the other live streams because I was on vacation for a while. I hadn't taken a vacation in about a month, about a year, because of the pandemic. I don't feel this is a time when a whole lot of other people should be preaching, but people need to hear the voice of their shepherd. It's interesting that it's been about a year now since we've been mired in this pandemic. And so many are worried about whether the economy will ever recover. I'm worried about whether people are going to ever recover, because we were created to live in community, and it's not good for people to be alone. The physical distancing connected to the coronavirus is damaging us in unimaginable ways. One of my brothers from the church said he finally caught on. When you say social distancing, that is the term that everybody is using, but we're not trying to social distance, we're trying to physical distance. Physical distancing is to keep us safe. Social distancing will make us sick, even sicker than we are. And social distancing is the impact of physical distancing. Every indicator, anxiety, depression, drug use, alcohol use, PTSD symptoms, suicide, are all up and rising. One of the indicators of the damage to humanity that few are talking about is despair. A brief definition of despair is hopelessness. I believe that there is not only a pandemic of COVID, but there is a pandemic of hopelessness. And in America, there is a rise in what's called deaths of despair, preventable deaths due to suicide, opioid and other drug overdoses, and deaths that are related to poor health behaviors. The United States is the only rich country in the world where mortality rates are increasing rather than falling. So the despair is connected to the meaninglessness of modern life in America. I've been pointing out on Sunday morning that Japan, Great Britain, and Canada have instituted a minister of loneliness, because people are in such situations where their bodies, they're dying and their bodies are not being found to 2 and 3 months later. Loneliness is at epidemic proportions. If you're African American, bad times didn't start with the coronavirus or the death of George Floyd. We have been fighting despair in this country for 400 plus years. Whereas the Black church had always helped us to forestall despair, unfortunately, the Black church has lost a great deal of its relevance. Not too long ago, I was reading a Canadian theologian by the name of Douglas John Hall, and he calls attention to the anxiety of meaninglessness and the emptiness that he believes afflicts the general public in North America. His view comes from the fact that salvation history, how it developed, and the context in which it was developed. We're looking at the meaninglessness by working our way through the book of Ecclesiastes. The book is about vanity or meaninglessness. Ecclesiastes 1:1, the word of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem. Vanity of vanity, says the preacher, vanity of vanity, all is vanity. The word vanity is habel in the Hebrew. It's commonly used of anything transitory, evanescent, that is transient, tending to vanish like vapor, frail, vain, empty. Solomon, that's who we believe is the writer of Ecclesiastes, is saying that all of life is nothing but futility. It is marked by despair, meaninglessness, and purposelessness. Please notice with me our next passage of scripture as we work our way through this book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes 4:13. A poor yet wise lad is better than an old and a foolish king who no longer knows how to receive instruction, for he has come out of prison to become king, even though he was born in his kingdom. I have seen all the living under the sun throng to the side of the second lad who replaces him. There is no end to all the people, to all who were before them, and even the ones who will come later will not be happy with him, for this too is vanity and striving after the wind. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word. It is the word of God. Let's begin with the anomalies. The first anomaly. There are two anomalies here to consider. First, Solomon gives us a hypothetical example of what can happen when a man rises from prison to the throne. This is about the failure of the political process, the failure of political success, because this poor lad was better off being poor, wise, and young rather than being an old and foolish king. This is very applicable to where we are right now. It's applicable because of all of the political leanings and stuff that is going on right now. This young man had everything, but he didn't know it. He was young and he was wise. You say, but he had no money. A lack of money is no real problem for those who are wise. He evidently used his wisdom and popularity to become king. He gained political success. But after he became king, he became old and foolish. He no longer knew how to take advice. When he was a child, he was open to learning and counsel. That takes a bit of humility. But now his position and his age had blinded him to his own limitations. He doesn't know how much he needs counsel and how much he needs instruction. This is an anomaly or a departure from the norm. How could one so wise become so foolish? Because he began chasing popularity and political success. Therefore, he aligned himself with paganism for political success. Popularity and political success do not guarantee continued wisdom. Unrealistic expectations placed in these things can lead to meaninglessness. His unrealistic expectations of his youthful wisdom cause purposelessness, meaninglessness, and burnout. But there's a second anomaly. The lad who had been so wise became foolish. This lad who had been so popular would lose his popularity and his position. The person who replaced him as king would experience the same rise to popularity and the subsequent fall to obscurity. Solomon now moves from the anomaly and begins the analysis. The rise. The young man's rise was meteoric. He rose from a poor lad in prison to the throne. But he had three strikes against him. He had been born in prison, number one. He was born poor and had no money, number two. Because he was born poor, he was not of noble birth, number three. Yet he rose to the throne of the kingdom. He must have ridden the crest of the wave of popularity. It was a phenomenon of life that sometimes takes place. It was, in fact, a miracle of sorts. God is over all things that happen on the earth, and I believe that he allows some of these occurrences for his own reasons and glory and because he has given us the power of choice. But this young man should keep in mind that God was allowing him to enjoy this popularity. We are familiar with the process of popularity because of the fame of entertainers of our day. Some have risen to world fame and popularity, and it seems that they have done so overnight. Please forgive me tonight. I'm going to date myself in my examples, but ain't no use in trying to escape how old I am. Entertainers like Elvis, the Beatles, Michael Jackson have all enjoyed an extraordinary fame and popularity that cannot be accounted for. But without God, it means little. In fact, it is God who allows them to experience the things that they experience. They should have thanked God for what good they derived from that popularity. The same phenomenon can be seen in the electing of the President of the United States of America. But all of these stars ought to remember that their rise in popularity has caused the fall of another from popularity. They should remember that their own fall from popularity can be as sudden as their rise. Job said, "The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." And so, even though the outcome was from complex choices allowed by God, the ancient Israelites attribute everything to God, but they do so without blaming him. Let's move to the rival. Popularity is often brief, very unstable. People are fickle. They change their minds like the proverbial wind. And as all the people had thronged to the side of this young lad on his way to the throne, so Solomon had seen all people likewise thronged to the side of his rival. Solomon is speaking from experience. He said, "I have seen But where had he seen it? He had seen it in the history of the kings of Israel and Judah. He had seen it in his own family, for he was born in the line of king. He had seen it with his own father. Example number one, when David was firmly established on the throne of Israel, his own son, Absalom, chased him off the throne by gaining popularity with the people. Example number two, when David was dying, Solomon's half-brother Adonijah attempted to take over the throne. And Adonijah was gaining considerable favor with the people until the plot was discovered and David had Solomon proclaimed king. And that immediately swung with people's favor back to Solomon. People and popularity are as unstable as the weather in northeastern Ohio. And no matter how popular or successful you have been, people will leave you and throng to the side of your rival one day. Let's move to the reality. Solomon knew from experience, that is the experience of his family, his own experience as king, that no matter how many people were happy with him at his anointing, there were others who would not be happy with his reign. He knew that all the people that would be happy with him coming on, some others would be happy with his successor until he took office. Then after he took office, they would be waiting on his successor to come and take his place. No matter how many thronged to the side of the king on his way up, just as many may be unhappy while he is in office. So think just for a moment tonight about the president of the United States of America, swept into office on the red carpet of political campaigns, campaign promises, political convention, the popular vote, the electoral vote. The inauguration is happy. It's a positive time. But in a few short months, the red carpet of popularity will be snatched from under him or her, and he will fall hard into the dirt of criticism. His critics will seem to outnumber and outweigh his supporters, and this is even more contentious in our day. Fame runs in the same vein. Those who are famous today are often forsaken tomorrow by the same public that idolized them before. Please forgive me again. My examples will date me. I thought about the first Miss Black America, Vanessa, and how she went from fame to infamy. I thought about Joe Louis and how he went from the center of world attention to a doorman at a casino. I thought about Mark Spitz, who still holds the Olympic record for the most gold medals won by one man. He went from the talk of the world to total obscurity. And I thought about Richard Nixon, who went from the president of the United States to a scapegoat for all of Americans' anger with crooked politics and given a name, Tricky Dick. Solomon said that this is vanity. It's striving after the wind. It's useless and meaningless to seek after fame and popularity of political office. It is useless and meaningless to seek advancement and popularity as an end in itself. This is a frustrating situation. This will lead to meaninglessness. It'll lead to purposelessness, for neither advancement, nor fame, nor popularity, nor political success are lasting or satisfying. Don't build your expectations in life on something as shaky as popularity or political success. Unrealistic expectations are one of the contributing factors to burnout. Build your hope on things eternal. Hallelujah. Hold to God's unchanging hand. I'm glad that there is a God and that his hand is unchanging. It's not moving and changing and ephemeral, but it is solid and there and trustworthy. So let's consider the answer that we have been looking at for these weeks. This is actually the 11th week, and I will continue until I finish this series of cultural anxiety and dealing with the anxieties that are bringing about purposelessness and meaninglessness. But we've been working on this first, first 11 messages using what is given as the answer in the fifth chapter and the 18 through the 20th verses. I've been reading them. I won't read them tonight because of time and don't want to insult your intelligence, but we've been doing it and reading them each time. Let's look at the lessons we can learn in the answer that is given in Ecclesiastes 5, 18 through 20. First, God's way is good. God's purpose course of living is good. That means it's without moral problems. God's way of life, it's good, it's fitting. If we would follow the course that God has set for us, we would have fewer moral problems. We would see how things work together for good for those who love him and those who are called according to his purpose. Popularity has a lot of moral and practical problems. People get into a lot of trouble because they refuse to follow God's prescribed plan for their lives. Let's make sure we understand tonight, you don't have to follow his plan. God has given you a choice, but you would be wise to do so. B, God's way is beautiful. God's plan can also be just declared to be very fine, a beautiful plan to follow. It possesses aesthetic and practical qualities along with its moral perfections. God's plan is beautiful because it is so practical and it makes such good sense, such good spiritual sense. It allows no room for amoralistic rivalry and competition. If we were not so full of humanistic philosophies, we would understand the beautiful and practical plan of God. Next, enjoyment is a part of the plan of God. We only have a few years on this earth, and God wants us to enjoy them. Now, I know that's probably a new concept for some of you that have not heard me before, or who have not heard me over the course of time. God is not some cosmic killjoy in the sky who wants you to be sad. I grew up in the Pentecostal church, and by all rights, looking and listening to them, God was a killjoy. He didn't want you to be happy. He didn't want you to look good. He didn't want you to smell good. He wanted you to just be in pain and in misery. And the more you suffered, the more God liked it. Well, that's not the God I see in the Bible. Fearing God and keeping his commandments is the principal end to be sought, but enjoyment is a byproduct of doing those two things. The plan of God was never meant to stifle our pleasure and joy in possessing things or in living life. But unrealistic expectations placed on popularity and political success will cause a stifling of God-given enjoyment. Remember what we've been studying on Wednesday night, and if you haven't been there, you need to try to catch up and go back and look at some live streams that I've been doing and working on, that we look at the fact that enjoyment comes from God. And that when we attempt to force and grasp and make things happen is when we start to have difficulty. We must learn to walk in the presence of God and accept the things. And so in that teaching, we've been looking at the fact that Adam and Eve, they weren't so much that they were wicked and trying to rebel against God, but they were immature and they were impatient. And that immaturity and that impatience brought about some very negative impact in their life. I mean, isn't that our story? It's my story. Is that your story? I'm not trying to rebel against God. I'm not angry with him or anything, but I just want to get some stuff, and I want to get it sooner and quicker, perhaps, than he wants me to have it. I haven't moved my way through. I haven't grown enough in order to be able to handle it. It's like my 8-year-old son saying, I want to drive. And the answer is no, not no, never, but no, not now, not until you mature, not until you grow. And so God wants us to grow so he can put certain things in our hands so that we can enjoy them in their maximum potential. Let me go to the next point. Enjoyment is part of our reward. Enjoyment comes from God. It does not come from doing things better than our neighbor. It does not come from competition. In fact, the man who has learned the secret of enjoyment as a gift from God will seldom become anxious over the length of his life or the state of his life, because that is not what he is preoccupied with. He has too much joy in living to brood over his state. Rather, each day ought to be taken as a gift from God. If you get up every day and say, thank you, Lord, for another day. I just thank you that you've given me another gift to be able to live out. It's called the present, and that's because it's a gift from God. And when you have that kind of thankfulness, that kind of approach, he will not become anxious. You will not become anxious over transient and impermanent popularity, position, and other kinds of so-called advantages. Paul had learned that lesson. He tells us in Philippians 4 and 11, not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I'm 69 years old. I think I'm learning now, starting to learn how to be content with where I am every day in life. And then finally, Christians are to be occupied with God. Christians won't be constantly examining their state and their lives in this world if they are occupied and delighted in the inner recesses of their lives, in their hearts and in their minds with God himself. Popularity is not the constant thought on their minds when you are following God. Consequently, the dark side of man's brief life is relieved or exchanged for gladness in the plan of God. In other words, we have the promises of God and the measure of faith that he has provided for us through salvation to live a joyful life in expectation of the inevitable outcome, eternal joy and peace in his presence. In his presence, there was fullness of joy. At his right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. If people view events in their lives individually, compartmentalize their lives, and lose the perspective of God, meaninglessness is sure to occur. If we keep looking at our popularity, examining our position, this will distort our perception about what life is all about. We must keep our eyes on Jesus. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Now here's the phrase, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, fixing our eyes on Jesus, fixing our eyes on Jesus, fixing our eyes on Jesus. We got to get our eyes, our mind, our hearts, our everything on Jesus. That perspective will change our realities. And we can only gain the perspective of God from his word, from his local body. For without the local body of church and saints, we are diminished. We need one another. I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. So tonight, let me pray for you, because there is great anxiety. There's great fear. There's great loneliness. There is great tiredness as the pandemic is wearing us out. Elder Johnson used to say that the devil is wearing out the patience of the saints. I think this pandemic is wearing out the patience of the saints and of everybody else. Let me pray for your patience tonight. Lord, I pray that the anxieties of this world and of this time would not be the uppermost thing in our lives, and that you would, by the power of the Holy Ghost, refresh us, and that we would move into a place where we are have our eyes fixed on you, and that you begin to rejuvenate, to revive, to lift us up, to build us up, so that we have a joy and a peace that surpasses understanding, that people would not be able to understand what is it that is impacting you to be so joyful. It is, and we will be able to answer, it is the power of walking with you through Jesus and through the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father, tonight for this opportunity. Thank you that we have one another. Thank you that we have this medium until we can get back together. We honor you. We look forward on the last Wednesday night of the month, Father, that we will license some and ordain some, but all of this is because of you. We thank you tonight, and we pray these things in your Son Jesus' name, and amen. Have a great night.